Today we have with us nuclear physicist and author of My Big Toe, Tom Campbell. Hello, Tom.
Hi, Daghda.
Tom, in your lectures you mentioned Swedish philosopher Professor Nick Bostrom, who is on the faculty at Oxford. You mention him because he put forward the virtual simulation argument, but he's also deeply interested in transhumanism. Transhumanism means more than human. Nick Bostrom opens one of his lectures by saying that the biggest problems facing the human race are death and unhappiness. He is saying that science is now on the way to resolving those issues. There is a fast-developing wide range of technologies that will be available that will increase lifespan, physical and mental functionality by artificially enhancing the human body with microchips, prosthetics and new and improved vital organs. Also, it is being postulated that the unhappiness problem could be solved by introducing new drugs with far less side effects than 20th century antidepressants. There is, of course, a military application for this new technology. Armies with greater strength and endurance, superior cognition, better teamwork and fearlessness are already being planned. The American government is investing in introducing laws that will protect those who may be profoundly artificially enhanced. It has to be decided, for instance, where boundaries would lie between human and cyborg. Bioethicists are discussing the moral and ethical issues of such enhancements. Some transhumanists believe that bioenhancement is a natural way to evolve. We've evolved to the point where we have the technology to enhance functionality on all of these levels, and so they believe that the next step is to use it to evolve the human race. So Tom, in the light of MBT theory, where self-realisation of the necessity to move towards increased compassion, cooperation and quality of consciousness is the linchpin of human evolution, can you give us an MBT perspective of the impact that these emerging technologies might have on the evolution of mankind?
That's a long question. Okay, let's start. First of all, the thing that caught my attention was that the two biggest problems facing humanity are death and unhappiness. That is just not so. Okay, death is not a problem. Yes, it is a perceived problem among people, but it is not a problem. It's a necessary part of the process of us being here. So you don't solve a problem by creating longevity. You don't solve a problem by either slowing or, they say, stopping aging. You create a problem by, you know, stopping aging. You don't solve one. And secondly, unhappiness is not a problem, it's a symptom. Unhappiness is not a problem to be solved. That's our medical establishment has moved from being, should we say, focusing on causes to focusing on symptoms. Somebody comes in with an ache or a pain or a sore or a rash, they're given a pill to take the symptom away. We don't focus on causes nearly as much as we should. Now, of course, some medicine focuses on causes, but we tend to focus on the symptoms. Somebody comes in and has an ulcer, all right, well, we can give them Maalox to drink to get rid of the stomach acid. We can do other things. We can go in and cut out parts of the intestine and sew the rest back together. That's all symptoms. The ulcer isn't the problem. It's the cause of the ulcer that's the problem. Why do they have an ulcer? Okay. Well, it probably has to do with stress. It probably has to do with lifestyle. It probably has to do with what they eat. It has to do with lots of things. And it may just be a genetic proclivity toward ulcers. It might run in the family. But we need to work on those things, not on removing the ulcer. See, that's the symptom of the problem. Being unhappy is the result of having a low quality of consciousness. Being unhappy is a result of being fearful and having ego, ego being a derivative of fear. Okay. Also having beliefs. They're very limiting. So unhappiness isn't a problem to be solved. Unhappiness is a symptom that shows a problem that needs to be solved, which is low quality of consciousness. Okay? We need to become love. We need to grow up. We need to get rid of fear. These are problems that should be dealt with. When this problem gets, if those problems get dealt with, if we all got rid of our fear and our ego and our beliefs, expectations, if all those things disappeared, we wouldn't have unhappiness. We also probably wouldn't have ulcers. We probably wouldn't have nearly as much of all of our degenerative diseases as we have now. So that's the first thing that hit me is they're, you know, they don't understand what's a problem and what's a symptom. They're confusing those two. They're putting their focus on fixing something that is a symptom. And fixing symptoms doesn't fix the problem. Okay, now when it comes to death, death is a problem, so we want to fix death. All right, we eliminate death. When we eliminate death, we create a lot of other problems. And this idea that technology can solve everything is a mindset that just isn't so. Technology can't solve everything. There is not a technological solution to every problem. Growing the quality of your consciousness does not have a technological solution. You see, that's one. And there's lots of problems like that that don't have a technological solution. We need to not have this one-sided, you know, approach to all problems. You know, we have the technology, right? We can rebuild them, you know. It's not a technological problem. Okay, so some of the difficulties there, if we have, you know, if nobody dies, then is nobody allowed to be born? If we have nobody dying, but we have people being born, then obviously our population is increasing. Well, that can't happen indefinitely. I mean, it doesn't take, you know, much of an analysis to know that the Earth has a certain carrying capacity for humanity and all the other critters that are here. You can only get so many people here. When each of us have 1 square foot of space to stand on, and we're all shoulder to shoulder all over the dry land, you know, now what? You know, what do we do? Well, if we've been worrying about the cause by putting happy drugs in the water, you know, I mean, worrying about the symptom, but putting happy drugs in the water, we'll still have all that same fear and ego that we had in the beginning, which is the real problem. Well, what about a whole bunch of people with fear and ego and beliefs that are standing shoulder to shoulder on their 1 square foot of dry land? What do you expect from those people? War, fighting, annihilation. And if we have the technology to do these marvelous things, we have the technology to kill people by the hundreds of millions. Well, we won't have to worry about that population thing, will we? That'll take care of itself. The low quality of consciousness will see to it that we can have all the babies we want. And even though nobody dies a natural death, we can create a lot of unnatural death to take its place, because we have this low quality of consciousness, you see. We're not able to deal with the benefits of the technology until we grow up. We're not grown up enough for that sort of technology actually now. And probably we never will be. Why would we want to say, well, you know, you can have one child, or you can only every 10th family can have a child? Because nobody's dying, or everybody's living so long that we reach the carrying capacity. Well, that takes a big component of our existence away, right? Not having children. Mm-hmm. Is that going to create any stress? You think anybody will have a problem with that? Well, what will happen with this low quality of consciousness is the people who have the power will take the land, take the resources, and eliminate the people who don't have the power so that they can have space. And they can have all the babies they want, because they, just a few million people, aren't going to overpopulate the earth. So see what you've started? You've started this thing where instead of having war to grab each other's jewels and land and resources. Now you're grabbing space, and you're grabbing, you know, you're depopulating so that the good guys, you and your friends, can populate. Well, that's called genocide. So it looks like maybe rampant genocide would be the result of conquering the evil of death. I think replacing it with the evil of genocide wouldn't be nearly such a great leap forward. And I think that's where we would go. Now, if we could eliminate the fear and the ego, now maybe we could do something better than that. But you can't, you have to realize first what, you know, what's fundamental and what's basic. So that idea of living forever, and I know the people who are in that, they'd say, well, yeah, there's going to be population problems and food problems, and there's a carrying capacity of any environment. I mean, it's just, it is. Carrying capacity of the atmosphere, carrying capacity, you know, in the food, carrying capacity in the landmass. It's just, you get to the place where overpopulation is a problem. Oh, don't worry. Technology will solve that when we get to it. Everybody will be on happy pills. There won't be any genocide because we'll all be, you know, on happy pills. Well, that doesn't sound like, that sounds like, you know, makes 1984 by, you know, sound like a, you know, the book I'm referring to, makes the book 1984 sound like a picnic and a happy place to live. Technology is not the solution to all our problems. I guess that's the main thing. Some of these other things you mentioned, cyborgs, people who can see better, hear better, run faster, you know, the $1 million man, right? We can rebuild him, you know, we'll make him into a half man, half robot, and he'll perform wonderful, wonderful things. Well, okay, a lot of that might happen, you know, if we get that clever, and that is technology, and if somebody, what happened to the $6 million man, he crashed in a rocket or something, and got damaged. So if you can have the technology to rebuild him, why not? As long as he's still intact as a, you know, as a person making decisions, having a free will, then why not rebuild him? So these technological issues do have ethical ramifications. They are things we need to think about. And I applaud these guys, you know, transhumanists, I applaud them for doing that. It's like, let's not wait until it happens and then try to figure out whether it's a good idea or not, because that won't happen. You know, by the time we figure out it's a bad idea, we're already past the power curve of doing anything about it being a bad idea. So I agree with them. Let's think of all these issues of what could possibly happen because of our technology. These are technology-driven issues. What could our technology allow us to do? And what of that should we actually do? What of it should we maybe try to steer away from? So I think they're doing us all a favor by raising these issues and saying, come on, guys, we need to think about this ahead of time. This technological whirlwind changes fast. And if we don't start thinking about it now, and it happens 20 or 30 or 50 years from now, we're going to be run over by this technology just like we're run over by other technologies. And then we said, well, maybe that wasn't such a good idea. But by then it's too late. So, you know, I think Nick and the group of transhumanists that are trying to work these issues are right on in their interest of wanting to, let's look at these problems now, get some idea of where the most benefit is, you know, for the buck, steer our research into things that are going to be productive instead of the things that are going to cause us problems down the road. Smart thinking. So good for them. But they don't, it seems from the, you know, from what you told me, they don't really have a good grasp of what the issues really are. You know, that I see. It's not, now they're looking at all the issues. They may say, well, we're looking at everything. Every possibility, and we're looking at it and seeing where it will go. Well, that's fine. That's fine. And there may be this, you said they're wondering about how do you do, what do we call a human and what do we call a cyborg? And well, that sounds to me like another ism, you know. That sounds to me, again, I use race as my example because I lived through that in the 1950s in the United States. What do we call a white man? You know, Well, you know, there was a lot of intermixing there when, you know, black women became pregnant from white slave owners, and how white does a person have to be before they get the privileges of being white, you see? And we had all this thing, well, they had to have less than one, you know, 20th or 1/10, and, you know, we come up with all this stuff. Well, that's not good. So now we're talking about, is he a cyborg or is he a human? Well, I can see academically that's a question you might want to think about. But it sounds a little scary to me in the sense of, if he has a free will and if he has enough mental function to participate, then who cares what he is, right? It's like saying, well, why don't we let, you know, why do we not let dogs vote in our elections? Well, it's not because they're dogs and we don't, you know, dogs don't vote. And we can generalize it like that, but the reason we don't let them vote is they don't have the mental capacity to understand the issues. Not that they don't have a stake in the issues. Dogs might be interested in animal rights. They might be interested in the, you know, in the laws that are, you know, that concern them, just like we do. Every law doesn't concern us. There's certain subsets of laws that concern us more than others, and we're kind of keen on those, and we stay up with them, and we vote accordingly. Well, a dog could do that, but the dog doesn't have the mental capacity to understand the situation and make an intelligent choice. It has free will, but it doesn't have enough capacity to sort. But if it did, if the dog did have enough capacity and enough free will and enough ability to sort out the issues to be an intelligent voter, why wouldn't dogs vote? They've got a stake in what happens here. You see, so it's the same thing. Now, that's a silly one with dogs, right? Because, you know, I'm taking that to an extreme. But now we're talking about a cyborg that's half machine and half a man. And how do we tell the difference? And I'm thinking, well, why do you care? Why do you care what the difference is? What's the discrimination here on the difference? Cyborgs live in metal cans. They're not allowed to vote. You know, we keep them, you know, behind barbed wire fences. Well, they're stronger, faster, you know, better than us. You know, what do? Chain them down at night, you know, it's this kind of thing. If it has a mind able to comprehend what's going on and has free will, then I don't see that there's any need to discriminate between what's human and what's not. So that question kind of hit me as, well, what do you want to know for? What's important about determining whether it's human or whether it's a cyborg? Sounds kind of, well, I wouldn't say racist. I guess it is racist, human race against not human race. It sounds racist to me. It sounds like, but then I don't know all the things they're thinking about. You know, I'm not sure.
Legal issues. Our laws protect humans.
Well, laws should. Laws should protect everybody.
Hmm.
Laws should protect dogs and cats. Laws need to protect everyone. You know, it's like, will all the cyborgs have their own toilet? You know, maybe they don't need a toilet, but do they have to eat in their own, you know, at the back, they have to stand in the back of the bus? You know, do they have to have, you know, can't go in the same restaurants as the humans? I mean, why? You know, what's the point? We need to be treated according to our capacities and abilities. So the dogs and cats don't have a lot of capacities and abilities intellectually, so our laws take care of them. There's laws about not hanging them, you know, not hanging your cat by the tail from the clothesline. That's called cruelty. And somebody will get you if you do that. So we protect those who can't protect themselves, but everyone who has the wherewithal to participate, a mind, you know, an ability to see what's going on, and, you know, a free will to act, why wouldn't they be an equal participant in anything, whether it's where they ride on the bus or what restaurant or restroom they go to, or whether they vote or whether they don't. So that seems to me that the law there shouldn't be so discriminatory about is it a human or not a human. We discriminate on, is it capable or not capable?
Mm-hmm.
You know, can it make decisions, come to its own independent conclusions? Whatever. And does it have a stake in a society, well, then we probably ought to welcome it in. Now, if it's a computer, let's say it's just a conscious computer. Well, a conscious computer, you know, it depends on what it does. It may just look things up for us. We may say, computer, you know, how many angels can stand on the head of a pin? You know, and the computer goes off and comes back with an answer, you see. So, in that case, no, it's not interested in social issues. You know, there may not be a need to connect it to the social issues. It's not a social thing. Well, it sounds like a cyborg would be. A dog is a social thing, but they're not really, don't have the mental capacity to vote. Goodness, it's getting dark outside. We're going to have a low light problem here.
Okay, but that takes us nicely into, because what we're talking about then, when we've just been looking at these those issues, is that there's a limited perspective maybe going on here. Yeah. Limited perspective about death, limited perspective about consciousness maybe, because we have,
yeah.
If it's humans,
yeah.
Got prosthetics and it becomes a cyborg, it's still consciousness. So generally a limited perspective maybe,
yeah,
there.
And a limited perspective about happy pills are the solution to a low quality of consciousness. You know, drugs are the solution to people being unhappy. Just give them happy pills and they would be happy then. See, that's a viewpoint that says the only reason they're unhappy is because of some biochemical problem in their body. We just fixed the biochemicals and now they're happy. That's not the case. They're unhappy because of their low quality of consciousness. They're unhappy because of their... Yes, and that may result in this biochemistry, true, but there's a reason for that. If you take away their ability to get feedback concerning their own growth and being, in other words, you take away the unhappiness that's a result of their fear, how are they going to learn to get over the fear? Oh, well, they don't have to get over the fear. We'll just make them blotto, and the fear won't make any difference. Well, you don't want a nation of zombies. And so, you see, if you understand reality and what we're doing here, you'll see that removing the symptoms is sometimes not what you want to do. The symptoms there are necessary, you know. We need those symptoms. They're our feedback that help us grow, which is what we're here for. So if the technology starts getting to the point that it is eliminating the value of this learning lab, you can't learn here anymore because everybody's drugged, everyone's in a stupor, everybody's happy and old, you know, then, you know, this virtual reality, see, these people don't understand this as a virtual reality, this virtual reality then becomes not so effective, not so useful. Well, if you're the larger consciousness system and the virtual reality isn't so useful, now it's just a whole bunch of old people shoulder to shoulder, you know, all over the planet and drugged so they don't try to kill each other, then what good is it? See, the virtual reality now has failed its purpose because the feedback's been taken away. Mm. Well, you know, if that was my virtual reality, I'd delete it and start over. I'd back it up, you know, 500 years or something and start it up again and figure... that let's hope these guys are smarter next time, you know, and they don't take these routes. So I see what they're trying to do, this transhumanist, is very good. They're trying to look ahead at where we might go. And that's laudable. But I see they really don't understand the nature of the reality. They don't understand it's a virtual reality. They don't understand that this is a consciousness evolution virtual reality trainer. They don't understand a lot of the basics of what's going on here. And that's almost as dangerous, a lack of understanding, than all these technologies and things that they're trying to understand, because they might be dangerous. So I kind of see the lack of understanding is as dangerous as the things that they're trying to study.
And if they have a limited perspective, then we'll say areas of science that have a limited perspective. So what would this mean then for futurist physicists who are postulating things like warp speed and populating distant planets.
Yeah, well, it's the same sort of thing. It's scientists full of themselves with the idea that technology can solve every problem. They just have this belief that technology can do anything, everything. Well, they don't understand the reason why we're here. Technology isn't really the solution to much of anything that's terribly important. The things that are really important are not technology problems, you see. So it's a very biased viewpoint that sees the world in a mostly in a Newtonian vision of a big clockwork. There's this big machine and it's clockwork. And this, you know, we all move according to the way the gears turn. It's this huge machine, and if you could specify all of the, you know, all of the particles, if you could specify them completely, you could predict where everything would be from then on, you know, this sort of thing. It's a deterministic reality. It's a physical, objective reality. Well, that's wrong. It isn't. And for those of you who are just getting this video and not the rest of them, don't turn pale when you hear me say things like that. There's a lot of logic behind that. Go to YouTube, listen to the Saturday at the Calgary lecture, and you'll find out why I'm saying these things. There's good reason for it. But we don't have time to do that here. So that's this issue. You see, if you have that clockwork mentality of the universe, then it's just a matter of fixing the clock. You can make this clock be or do whatever you want. You can make everybody happy, you can make everybody live long, you can whatever. It's just a matter of going in and adjusting this gear and winding that spring and fixing things, and technology can do all of it, because this whole reality is just one big technical problem that's moving on. You see, we've got the science. You know, we understand how it all works and we can fix it. Now the transhumanists say, we not only can fix it, but we can stick our foot in it too. You know, we can screw it up as well, and we need to be thinking about how we might do that, how we might keep from screwing it up. Yay, you know, good idea. But the fundamental viewpoint is just not good. This isn't a big clock machine, and what's wrong with it doesn't have a technological fix, you see. Technology isn't the thing that fixes everything. There's things technology can't do. And one of these that you mentioned is this, conquering space. We're going to spread out to all the planets and, you know, all the galaxies and all this, you know, given enough time. And one of the problems with this idea of us spreading out to all the galaxies that we have is that our sun is not an old sun. In other words, our planet is not an old planet, because our sun got there first, and then we had planets, and then the planets had to cool and, you know, get to a point where they could evolve things like us. So there's some other sun, some other place, that's a much older sun, that should have had evolution take root and evolve things that would be hundreds of millions, if not billions of years in process, beyond us, older than us, if you will. They've been in the evolution game for, say, 100 million years, longer than we have. Well, were we just fast and they're just slow? There's no real good reason why that should be. Well, then the question is, where are they? If they're a billion years ahead of us, I mean, we're looking at doing this thing out in the stars in the next, you know, several hundred years, certainly the next century, you know, that kind of thing. Maybe the next millennia. We don't see it hundreds of thousands of years before we get there. We see it as in the near future. Maybe 200 or 300 years, you know, that kind of thing. Well, where are these people that are a billion years ahead of us? Why haven't they come here and said hello? They've been traveling all over the universe now for a billion years. You see, well, maybe not. Maybe only 900,000 years. You know, maybe it took another 100,000 years to get there. So they've been traveling around this universe for hundreds of thousands of years, yet we don't see anybody. Now there's two reasons that can explain that. And it's not that it's one or the other, they both could be true. Or it could be, well, we'll just talk about them first before we get to that. They both could be true. One is, in order to make space travel to distant planets and distant galaxies a reality, you need to be able to go faster than the speed of light. Because the universe is really big. The nearest star is 4.5 light years away, and that's the very, I shouldn't say the nearest, our sun is the nearest star. Outside of our solar system, the nearest star is 4.5 light years away, Alpha Centauri. It's a doublet. 4.5 light years means it would take light 4.5 years to go from Earth out to Alpha Centauri and 4.5 years to come back. That's a 9-year round trip. Okay, that's the nearest to us other than our own sun. Now, the ones that are farther away are hundreds of thousands of years, millions of light years. So light travels out 1,000,000 years and it gets there and it'll take 1,000,000 years to come back. That's 1,000,000 light years away. Well, our universe is that big, you see. It's very, very big. People don't understand how big this thing is. Well, if we're going to populate a planet that is even just, you know, 10,000 light years away, that's a pretty near planet. That's probably even in our own galaxy. Probably even got out of our galaxy yet. Now, I don't know. I'm not an astrophysicist. I don't have all those numbers on the tip of my tongue. But probably 10,000 light years is still in our own Milky Way. We're not even out of the galaxy. And it takes 10,000 years to get out there at the speed of light and 10,000 years to come back. Imagine the conversation. Hello! 20,000 years later, comes back. Yes, we hear you. You know, it's a long conversation if you know, you wait 20,000 years to answer the question. Well, by the time the question gets answered, the question is, you know, OBE. You know, it's not of any interest anymore. 20,000 years have gone by, and whatever it was you were talking about probably isn't relevant anymore. You see, so this traveling to other places, you're going to have to go faster than the speed of light. Otherwise, it's not going to work. Well, these scientists and technologists feel that the speed of light is just, we can overcome that with technology. Someday, we'll be like, you know, Star Trek. You know, we'll be like Captain Kirk, and we can ask Scotty to put us into warp drive, and we're going to be going faster than the speed of light. Warp 5, that's 5 times the speed of light, you see. So they just believe that that'll be true because it's technology, and technology can do anything. Well, it's not like that. They don't understand why C is a constant. Physics in general doesn't understand why C is a constant. They know it appears to be a constant, but then technology has conquered a lot of things that appeared to be impossible. It appeared to be impossible to, you know, take your boat and go east and come back from the west. That would have seemed like a crazy idea. Well, you know, we can do that now because the globe is round and we can, you know, chug our boat all the way around it. But at a time, that would have said, that's impossible. If you go far enough to east, you drop off the edge. You know, so science says, well, we've done the impossible before. No big deal. We'll beat that speed of light. Well, it's because they don't understand why it's a constant. It's a constant because that's fundamental to the virtual reality that we're in. It's like this. We're in a virtual reality that's computed. All computed realities are, we can call them simulations. They work on a time loop. If they're dynamic, they have a time loop. We have delta T, you know, goes around every time delta T goes through the loop, one delta T worth of time gets added. So here we are at, you know, T equals, you know, 10 seconds, delta T goes around, now we're at T equals 10 seconds plus the delta T. Goes around again, we're at t, you know, time equals t plus 2 delta t, and so on. So that's how simulations work. Now, in a simulation, you have, just like on your computer screen, you have pixels. You know, you have resolution in a virtual reality. The computer only computes to some level of resolution. You only get your TV picture to some resolution, and you just fill in all the little pixels, and that makes your reality. Okay? In our virtual reality, we have a quantum of volume. That's the smallest volume that you can have, because that's all the more the computer computes the reality to. Okay, so we have that. This is not a continuous world. Everything's digital here. Time is digital, delta t's. You know, that's the quantum of time, is that delta t. Volume is digital. And one way to look at that is if you're scientists out there, you know, you have Planck's length. Well, it takes Planck's length and cubit, you know, like a cube. Well, that would give you kind of a rough order of a quantum of volume. Okay. That's as good a guess, I guess, as we have. I wouldn't really say that has to be a quantum of volume, but that's about as good a guess at what a quantum, you know, about the size of a quantum of volume would be. It would be Planck's length cubed. So we have this quantum of volume, and every delta t in this simulation, something can move from one quantum of volume to the next quantum of volume. Next delta t, it can move to the next quantum of volume. Now it's delta t to the next quantum of volume. Why does it have to move sequentially? Because otherwise our reality would be very crazy. It would teleport. You know, it's here, another delta t, it's someplace else. In order to make this a isotropic reality where we have things that look continuous, it appears to be continuous because our delta t is so small. We have to move from one to the next, to the next, to the next. They all have to be adjacent to each other. We can't skip and jump things, okay? That doesn't make a good design here. So you get your lowest point. It's just like with your pixels. What if they only put light in every other pixel? Well, you'd look at a screen that had a bunch of little black holes in it, right? It's not right. The whole thing needs to look continuous. Yet it is only made up of these individual chunks, but it looks continuous. But you don't skip pixels on purpose. You skip them if there's something wrong with your display, but you don't skip them on purpose. So now, why is C constant? Because that's moving from one pixel of volume to the next pixel of volume in one delta T, because this is a virtual reality and it's simulated. Well, that's the nature of this reality. That's our whole universe. You can't move information any faster than that. See, that's as fast as it goes. So there is a big problem with scientists saying, oh, C, we'll go faster than C. It's just, well, you're not probably going to go faster than C because it violates the basic fundamental structure of the reality that we're in. That's why C is a constant in the first place. Mass, you know, I'm talking about mass now. Not going faster than C. I'm not necessarily even talking about information, because information is non-physical. Information doesn't have mass, doesn't have weight, doesn't take up volume. You know, it's non-physical. But physical stuff, mass and matter, is not going to move faster than C, because it's the way our virtual reality is made. So once you understand that, this idea about, oh, no problem, we'll get by C, we'll get in our little rocket ship and we'll say, Scotty, warp 5, and Scotty will put his engines in, and, you know, there we'll be going 5 times faster than light. Not likely to happen because of the fundamentals of virtual reality. Okay. So that's one thing. You know, and again, I'm not saying it's impossible, because I know in a virtual reality almost anything is possible. And the reason I say that is, what if they changed the structure? What if they changed delta t? You know, what if they made that smaller? That would mean things could go faster. You know, there's ways of getting around that. So it's not like it's impossible, but it's unlikely. It's kind of impossible of us doing it. It would have to be done at the level at which the simulation is produced, not at our level from inside the simulation. So us doing it, we're not going to do that.
And just to add for a moment, when you're saying if they change, we're just talking for they, we can for the moment.
It's the larger consciousness. Yeah, the larger consciousness system is what I'm talking about. Consciousness, okay, virtual reality, I'll say this, but if you go to Calgary, you'll get all of this. You know, this virtual reality is computed reality. Consciousness is the computer. Consciousness is a digital information field. Okay, so we'll just leave it at that. Go listen to Calgary and you'll get all the, you know, all the science there. So that's one thing. It's very cavalier to think that technology will solve everything.
So the speed of light remains constant unless the system changes. Warp speed, faster than the speed of light, to get to these other planets is extremely unlikely.
It's extremely unlikely we're going to get anywhere. And if we do, it's extremely unlikely that anybody would have even remembered that we went. Mm. You know, if we go out to something that's, you know, something close, let's say just 50 light years away, it'd be 100 years later. Well, we go out there, it's 50 years, then we... That's even at the speed of light, right? But let's say we can go half the speed of light. Well, it'll be 100 years to get there. 100 years, and then 50 years for a light signal to come back to say, hey, we made it. And that long? Do they care? Do they care anymore? You know, you've been gone for three generations of, you know, of humanity.
And I've sort of seen the futurist physicists generally sort of talking about... well, you know, if we overpopulate this planet and we burn through all the resources, soon enough we're going to have this new technology that's going to be able to take us at warp speed to other planets where we can do the same thing.
Yeah.
But the idea is that we can, you know, we'll be able to do this no matter what happens here. If we do make a mess of it all, we can go somewhere else, which brings us very nicely to, in this virtual simulation then, what about the concept of all these other planets being, you know, populated?
Right. That's the second thing that bears on this idea of populating the universe or some part of the universe that's populated coming here. Mm-hmm. One, it's extremely, extremely hard to do that if you're going to move mass in this universe, physical mass, anywhere else. And this idea that, well, it would take a long time, but if we could just get to Alpha Centauri and then populate that, and you could just get to the next nearest one and just get to the next nearest one, possibly, but you'd get to a point soon that communicating back here would be so problematical, you know, that it's almost like that's just off and gone. And that's a possibility, but even that would be sending people out probably frozen so that they stopped very, very fast. They wouldn't age as much. And, you know, years and years later, they might end up someplace. That's not exactly what they have envisioned. You know, they have envisioned kind of a warp speed thing. They're sending people out that you'll never hear from them again because it takes too long for the, you know, the light to go back and forth. That's not really what they're thinking about. That could work slowly, but it's difficult because Alpha Centauri may not have a planet. You may have to go 50 light years, you see, to find an inhabitable planet. Well, 50 light years now. You know, that's a long time. We don't travel light speed. We travel at a fraction of light speed. It's not likely we'd even travel, you know, to 50% light speed. I think that would be difficult. Mass, I'm talking about mass now. You get mass at 50% of light speed, you got one tremendous amount of energy if we're talking about a, you know, spaceship. How do you slow that thing down? How do you land that thing somewhere? You know, there's lots of problems like that that require, you know, a lot of work. If you're going to go 0.8, 0.9 light speed, you're now talking about tremendous energies if you're moving a bunch of bodies. You're moving, you know, 1,000 people in a big ship. Well, you're talking about lots and lots of mass that's got a huge amount of energies and dealing with all of that. So it's a problem. We're more likely to go like 0.1 of light speed or 0.01. of light speed, which then is going to take you even longer. It's going to take you 100 times longer to do it than light speed. Well, okay, the second thing about populating the larger universe is that, yes, probability tells us that there are lots of suns that could have planets. It's just likely, right? And that these planets could very well be like Earth. And biology could get started there. I mean, if it did it here, why couldn't it happen somewhere else? Why are we so special? And there's no reason for us to be so special. So the idea is that we're not. And it probably has happened lots of other places, because there are so many billions of stars. There's bound to be some of those that ended up kind of like our solar system, and life emerged on it. Okay, that's just a good bet. So then where are they? You know, it's the question here. Why haven't they come knocking on our door? Well, there's another answer to this question besides the fact that it's not that likely that we'll ever exceed speed of light with moving mass. And that is that this is a virtual reality. Now, this virtual reality is meant as a consciousness evolution trainer. And it serves that function. It's a simulation. It started with the big digital bang, where there was this computer and it put a lot of energy, had input constants and a rule set, and it expanded and whatever, and we have our sun, and they have all these other suns too. All came out of it. Now, this larger consciousness system was looking for a learning lab, a consciousness trainer. Okay. Did this system need a million consciousness trainers? Did it want to populate all the possible places in this universe, you see, that could perhaps have evolved? Or is this one enough? Or maybe three. Maybe three of them are enough. You see, it's not a given that evolution is taking place. Now, evolution is a computation. It's allowing the simulation to continue to evolve down that path, to calculate what happens next. Okay, there's probabilities, things happen, and what happens, you know, it's a building on things. If you're running a big simulation, you have limited resources. You have limited needs. Well, here, the limited resources might not want to populate, you know, a million different systems. One may be enough. Or like I say, maybe three. So, and besides that, this is just one simulation. You could do another simulation that's a whole different universe. Another whole universe, you know, not this universe. But you have this universe here and say, well, then you could use it to populate these others, but I only need one. Let's just say I only need one. It's all I need. There's 7 billion people on this planet, and that's enough for me to do what I need to do with consciousness evolution. And I've got other universes, other places, and other things. And this one, that's all I need. So we let the simulation work itself out in evolution in this place. Earth, sun, so on. And it works its way out, and here we are. The rest of the simulation, we say, stop. Don't progress that out. Don't calculate all the ramifications of what happens there. Just hold off on that. We really don't have enough resources, or we don't really need that much data, you know. So you may, it's a digital process. You can calculate just as much as you need. And just to say a priori, they're all out there, they're all evolving, just like us, is because they don't understand the nature of reality, you see. So it may be that this Earth and this Sun is the only one that the simulation let progress that far to see what happened. And again, you could guess why. Maybe that's all they need. Maybe too many resources required. This is enough. You know, too many computational resources required. So nobody computes for the fun of computing. You compute because it meets a need.
So there's a likelihood that this PMR reality, which is this universe, it's likely that this Earth might be the only part of the experiment that's on the run.
I don't know if I'd say it's likely, but I'd say it's certainly possible.
It's possible.
It's possible that this sun and this planet may be the only one that was let run because of either resource limitations or because of need limitations. They didn't need any more. Or like I say, maybe there's 3 or 10. But in the size of this universe, and there's 3, there might as well only be 1. Unless all 3 of them are right next to each other. It's a huge universe. You know, it's a big universe if you to lose 3 marbles in. Mm-hmm. You know, particularly if they're randomly placed or whatever. You know, it's hard to say. But so it may be possible that the larger consciousness system is not progressing the simulation in any of them but this. Mm-hmm. And the rest of that universe out there is just background. Because it needed to be made in order to produce this sun and that planet. So you had to kind of had to do the whole thing. And when you do the whole thing, then you say, well, let's just progress this one and see where that one goes. Let the rest of it be. So now we look into the heavens with a telescope. Well, if the telescope's not too good, all we see is points of light. Points of light are real easy to simulate. You know, that doesn't take but just a few bits to simulate points of light. So now we look into a better telescope like Hubble, and we see not only points of light, but we see all these dramatic gas fields and all the rest of it, which show us some of the process of that evolution. Okay, so we see that. Now, if we look into it even more, we'll see more detail. We'll see all, you know, when we look, that's how virtual realities work. When you make the measurement, you get the response. You see? So when you make the measurement, you get the data. But it doesn't mean that data is generated all the time just to be there. You just get the data when you make the measurement. Now, that'd be hard for people to understand. In other words, when you look through your telescope, the larger consciousness system has to send data down your data stream to describe what the rule set says that you'll describe, the rule set being all the physics. Okay, so you'll get the data that describes what the rule set says would be there. You know, right down to the resolution of the reality, if you look that deeply. But that's it. Then you turn the telescope off, you look, you take your eyes out of the things, and it doesn't have to keep rendering that. It's just rendering data to you because you looked. If you don't look, it's just a point of light. Like I said, you do that for a couple of bits. Point of light's easy to model. So you don't have to send you a lot of data for point of light. But you look through Hubble, you get a lot more. You're not looking through Hubble, that data stream goes away. If you look again, you get the same one. You'll always get that same one because once you see it one way, that's the way it stays. And I've got other talks that I've given that talk about how that works, how the statistical process works, what's the, you know, the virtual reality, kind of the physics of the virtual reality, how that works.
Absolutely.
So we won't go into that here, but if that's confusing you and you're going, oh, that doesn't make any sense, it does make sense. You just aren't getting the basics of it because I'm not telling you them here. So that's the second thing. So one, speed of light isn't just something that we're going to run over with technology. Making mass go as fast as light or faster than light is a very difficult problem, and almost to the point I'll say that if we're doing it from the inside, it's impossible. We can't do that because the way the reality is constructed doesn't allow it. Doesn't allow you to do that. Otherwise,
it's back to the rule set.
It's just back to the rule set. It's the way it works.
Yeah.
Okay, now maybe you could do every other point instead of having them all sequential. You know, you could teleport from point to point to point or something, but see, there's nothing, you'd have to do that from the outside. The larger consciousness system would have to write the code so that you could take 2 steps instead of 1 every delta T.
Yeah.
So it's not something we're gonna do from the inhabitants inside the virtual reality. So I'm not saying it's impossible that it could never be done, but we're not gonna be the ones doing it. It might be enabled for us. Let's say our technology gets so good that, you know, that's the only thing left for us to do. Well, it may up the resolution. It may give us a smaller delta T, or it may allow us to skip steps, or something may change then in the rule set and the way it's done to enable us to do that. You see, that's what I'm thinking. See, so I won't say it's impossible that it will happen. It's just not going to be us forcing this virtual reality to let us push mass faster than the speed of light. Mm-hmm. We're not going to do it. It would have to be reprogrammed elsewhere. And there's no guarantee, there's no logic that says there is any other. Mm. Yes, statistics would say that there should be, but that's based on an assumption that all of them are calculating out through all the possibilities of evolution on all the planets that could possibly host it. That may not be the case. Why do it if you don't need it? Mm. Earth could be the only one. Or Earth and 100 others, or 10 others, or whatever. We don't know that. Yeah. So that's just an unknown. It's possible that Earth is the only one. So there's two good reasons, the speed of light being a constant, and we're not going to change it. And this may be the only one. Two good reasons of why haven't we seen them? Where are the ETs? Why haven't they come knocking on our, you know, come knocking on our door? Well, there's two good answers. But they're not mutually exclusive. Mm-hmm. You know, both are true. Both could be true. We might be the only one or one of a few, and C is a hard limit.
So they just have as hard a time reaching us as we would reach
them. Sure, we'd have as hard a time reaching us as we would reaching them. And it might not make that much sense.
So I can hear all the people who are now saying, as they're watching this on YouTube, saying, what about all the UFOs? What about the flotillas of UFOs that people have seen in the past, recently?
Yes, what about all the UFOs? Well, now you have a larger consciousness system that's creating this digital reality for us, and we are chunks of consciousness. Now, because the larger consciousness system is playing all ends of this game, right? It's the computer, the operating system, you know, it can decide how this virtual reality runs. Well, it can do anything it wants. If it wants to put a flotilla of lights in the sky, that's not a problem. All it has to do is put that image into the data stream of the people looking at it. Okay. Doesn't have to be little green men from a planet, you know, far, far away. It's just the larger conscious system can do that sort of thing, can make it look as if aliens are here anytime it wants. The larger conscious system can produce a crop circle that covers, you know, 20 acres of ground and shows up one night without making any noise. It's the computer. It's the programmer. Well, it's not really the programmer in as much as our reality, our virtual reality, is an evolved reality, not a programmed one. Larger conscious system didn't sit down and program, plant each blade of grass. It let it evolve. Right, and what evolved becomes the constraints that we as consciousness have to abide by those constraints to get into the virtual reality game, to interact, to get rid of our fear, become love, lower entropy. So consciousness evolves. It's all about evolution. That's the evolution of consciousness. And we're part of the system strategy for evolving consciousness. And consciousness evolves because it's evolve or die. You either evolve or you dissipate. So that's the... that's the idea. So let's see, where was I with that? What did you say?
The larger consciousness system is able to make things happen in order to make us maybe be aware that there's a bigger picture.
Right. The larger consciousness system can impose, can do a little programming here. All they have to do, again, is feed the right data in somebody's data stream. You know, when you're an elf on, you know, World of Warcraft, a data stream from the server that's running World of Warcraft is sent to your computer, which puts an elf on your screen. It's a data stream. And you as a player have your own personal data stream. Okay, now if the people at World of Warcraft wanted to send you a picture of some sort, they could. Now maybe if they're clever enough that they know the data stream, you know, if they could pick out the data stream that went to you, they could send whatever they wanted down that picture. They're probably not that clever because there wouldn't be any need to do that to access individuals. But they send, when you log on and you look at their map, whatever you're looking at, you get that data. You stop looking at it, It's not continuing to send that data to you. It sends you the data that you're looking at. If you're the only game player in the game, and you look this way, there's nobody else in the game but you, then the computer will send you the data to show you that look. You think it's still generating data on all the stuff around you and there aren't any other players in the game? Of course not. It only generates data to send in a data stream to a player. So if you're not looking, if nobody's there, if this is, you know, if there's not a single player in the game, the computer's not generating any data streams. See, our reality works like that too. So you want to look up in the sky and see a bunch of lights and watch them speed across and do right angle turns and flippy flips and stuff. And that's not hard. That's just, what, five people looking? A little points of light moving around in five data streams? Trivial. You see, why would the larger conscious system want to do that? Because it would like to wake us up a little bit and say, wake up, everybody. Reality is larger and stranger than you think. And this idea that we come to, if we see that, we say, oh, people from other planets, this is ETs, these are space people. Aliens are here making crop circles. Aliens are here with the little things of light. Well, aliens is a very easy way to, let's just say, simulating aliens is a very easy way to wake people up to our reality being bigger than what they thought. And that's good for the larger conscious system because that's one of the tools that it uses to succeed here. We have to realize that reality is much bigger than just the physical reality. Just what we see is all there is. There's more. It's bigger. By opening people's minds, it makes it easier for them to get even bigger pictures. Mm-hmm. Once you pry their mind open in this area, even if it's aliens, it helps their mind to be pried open in other areas. It makes them more open-minded if they get these things. So that's, I think, where most of these aliens come from. Besides that, you can travel among reality frames with your consciousness. And you can go to other reality frames with your consciousness. Most of us do that every night when we dream. Our consciousness interacts in another reality frame. Okay, the dream frame. You can go to other reality frames and exist as a spectator, just kind of looking. If you're like, you know, you have the kind of the God's eye view in a sense that you're hovering and looking at what's going on. Or you can participate. Well, I've done that other places. I'm sure other places have done that here. Also, people who see, you know, they wake up and there's a little green man with pointy ears at the foot of their bed. And he says, come with me. And you get beamed up, you know, that kind of thing. These are experiences of consciousness. Again, it's data. It's experiences of consciousness. Just like the dream reality, experience of consciousness. It seems really real. Because, look, this reality is just data. This, what we call physical reality, is just information. Well, that reality with the little green man and the pointy ears is just information. There's no reason why it wouldn't seem just as real as this one. And because we really don't understand the reality, we see the little guy at the foot of our bed, we assume that it's in this reality, not just a data stream coming to us, the player. And it's funny how these things usually happen when nobody else is around, you see. Mostly. Now, little lights in the sky, there can be a whole crowd of people around there. That's easy. You know, you don't have to explain a whole lot. But mostly they happen when nobody else is around. These things are happening, and they don't have to. I mean, it's not that hard for the system to send data streams to a dozen people or 100 people. And it's not that hard for it to coordinate a multiplayer game so that they are interactive, those 100 people, with the little green man. But mostly, it's a single experience of single person, and it is just as real as this is, just as real as this chair and this table and that camera. It's just that real because it's data, because this chair and that table are just data. So there's no reason why it would be foggy or whatever, and I say, no, I know it was real. Well, yeah, this is real, My dreams are real. Sometimes my dreams are foggy, but sometimes they're just as real as this. So it's that sort of thing. So why, you know, these people that see it, one, it's the largest consciousness system waking us up. Two, it's something that they're getting personally, something that challenges them, mm-hmm. something that challenges their fear, something that challenges their size of their perspective, something that they can now go on YouTube and tell people about that helps open other people's minds. You know, it spreads.
And also it can be a bleed through from another reality
frame. And also it could be someone from another reality frame coming here, but that's traveling by consciousness. That's not traveling by spaceship.
And by reality frame, you're talking about this reality frame that we're in now being our universe, our physical matter reality universe that's constrained by all of its rules.
Right.
And you're saying another one of those, another reality frame somewhere else, like this, but somewhere else.
Exactly.
You can travel to through consciousness expression.
Through consciousness expression. You can. And see, that's another thing. Why would the larger conscious system have to fill out, you know, a million Earth-like, Earth-Sun arrangements all over this universe? It can just as easily spawn another universe and get another whole variation of the rule set.
Another experiment, another set of rules, another way to evolve to see how profitable that type of simulation
for the amount
would play
of,
out.
For the amount of calculation, you know, to populate this one, another 20 planets and suns, it could take that same computation and do 4 or 5 more universes because it's a probabilistic simulation. It's not a deterministic simulation. You're doing a simulation. You're not simulating every molecule and every particle, you know, and every, you know, electromagnetic field, every photon. You're not simulating all that detail. You're only sending a data stream, just like in the World of Warcraft, you're only sending a data stream for what you're looking at. So if you're not looking through Hubble, you get points of light. If you're not looking, you know, if I'm not looking out the window, all I get is your wall. The wall behind me is not in my data stream. It's in your data stream, you see? And we both walk out of this room, it's in nobody's data stream. And it's not that you mean the, you know, the room doesn't exist anymore? Wouldn't that leave a hole in the building? No. See, this is a virtual reality. It only sends information to those who make the measurement, who are looking. It doesn't leave a hole in the reality. This is not a real building. This is a virtual building. These are virtual bodies.
It makes more sense to compute other PMR realities, other rather than add to the experiments that are in here, because they would all be, if we had more planets, they'd all be constrained by the same rule set. So it makes more sense to make another experiment that's constrained with other rules.
Exactly.
Right?
Here it would be parallel processing, and maybe that's good. Let's say you have in your virtual reality trainer. You might want something that would carry 20 billion individuals. Well, we can't carry 20 billion on Earth, so maybe you'd populate a couple of more. But there's no reason why you'd want everything out there that could be. You know, that seems like too much. It seems a little excessive parallel processing because it's all the same rule set. It's going to come out not exactly the same, but it's going to come out fairly similar as far as the constraints go. Mm-hmm. Because it's all this same rule set. So the constraints are going to be similar, so the products are going to be similar. And do you really need, you know, 100,000 things, all just slight small variations of the other perking along? A different universe from a different rule set might be more interesting. Mm-hmm. Now see, these are just conjecture though. You really don't know about that. But there are two good reasons why ETs haven't been knocking on our door, even though we have a relatively young son. So that's, you know, it's more of the same. Technology's hubris of, you know, we can do anything. Mm-hmm. We can solve any problem. And their idea that this is a big clockwork and the clock has to work the same all over. So if this happened here, then it ought to happen all over the universe. And if it happens all over the universe, then there ought to be literally thousands and not millions of things like the Earth and da 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 da, but where are they? You see. what, you know, the universe is expanding, always expanding. Actually, it's expanding at an accelerated rate. What is it expanding into? What was there before we expanded into it? How does it expand? How do you make more space? You know, how does our physical reality get bigger? From what? How? Is there somebody making space somewhere? You know, well, no, it's just a number in a computer. You know, you put a number in a computer, you can have your computer compute the surface area of a sphere that's 100 times bigger than our universe. It's just, you know, how many digits can the computer handle, right? If you can handle 64 decimal places, you know, you can compute all sorts of things. It's just a number in a computer. That's what expanding is. And it's got an acceleration. Why? Well, it's part of the rule set. You know, it doesn't need a reason more than that. Anyway, these same ideas, for those of you who are into science, these same ideas explain double slit, all those funny, weird things in quantum mechanics all fall out as perfectly rational. Entanglement and the rest of it. Go look at the Calgary lecture and you'll see all that explained.